A fine good morning to all of you. Nothing can be more enriching than starting a day by acknowledging our past, celebrating our present, and looking forward to a promising future. Proud history, promising future, 60 amazing years of Sri Venkateshwara College is what we are celebrating today. Revered Minister of State for External Affairs and Minister of State for Culture, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi has kindly consented to be our chief guest. Professor N.V. Verghese, Vice Chancellor, National Institute for Educational Planning and Administration, has consented to deliver the first Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh Memorial Lecture. Executive Officer, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, has consented to grace the occasion. To support us in this endeavor are our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor P.C. Joshi, Director South Campus, Professor Suman Kundu, Dean of Colleges, Professor Balram Pani, Registrar Dr. Vikas Gupta, former Principal and Padma Shri Awardee Dr. A. Shankara Reddy, University Representative on College Governing Body Professor D.P. Sarkar, University Representative on College Governing Body Professor Sanjay Kapoor, retired teacher Hindi Department and former Vice Chancellor Dr. R.K. Jain, and esteemed Chairman Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, Shri Y.B. Subbareddy Garu. Esteemed audience, our guests have finished unveiling the statue of one of the founders of Shri Venkateshwara College, Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh. Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh was an Indian freedom fighter, lawyer, social worker, and politician. She was a member of the Constituent Assembly of India and of the Planning Commission of India. A noted public activist for women's emancipation and for several such distinguished services, Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh was awarded the Padma Vibhushan by the Government of India. A warm welcome to our revered guests. May I request esteemed Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, Professor P.C. Joshi, Distinguished Vice Chancellor, National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, Professor N.V. Verghese, the Principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, Professor C. Sheila Reddy, and the Vice Principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, Dr. Venkat Kumar, to be kindly seated on the dais. The other distinguished guests may also kindly be seated. Director, University of Delhi, South Campus, Professor Suman Kundu, Dean of Colleges, Professor Balram Pani, former Principal, Sri Venkateshwara College and Padma Shri Awardee, Dr. A. Shankara Reddy, University Representative on Governing Body, Professor D. P. Sarkar, University Representative on Governing Body, Professor Sanjay Kapoor, retired teacher, Hindi Department, and former Vice Principal, Dr. R.K. Jain. I once again welcome you all and request you to be seated. Our chief guest, Honorable Minister of State for External Affairs and Minister of State for Culture, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, Chairman Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, Shri Y.B. Subbareddy Garu, and Executive Officer Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, are joining us online. I, on behalf of Sri Venkateshwara College, invite you all to this inspiring gathering on knowledge, wisdom, education, and our roles as higher education institutions. August audience, we have assembled here today to celebrate the 60th anniversary of this great educational institution, Sri Venkateshwara College, University of Delhi. Sri Venkateshwara College has played an important and enduring role in shaping many minds and in the process, the character of this nation. Since its inception in 1961, the college has aimed at imparting holistic education centered on creating well-rounded individuals with a strong knowledge base. The outcome of the efforts of three visionaries, Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh, Sri K.L. Rao, and Sri C. Anna Rao, today Sri Venkateshwara College, after completing 60 years, is lauded as one of the most sought-after educational institutions of the country that, in addition to achieving academic excellence, is also inclusive, participatory, and multilingual in character. The foundation stone of this college was laid down by none other than the renowned teacher and the first president of independent India, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. With these brief words, I once again welcome you all to the Diamond Jubilee celebrations of Sri Venkateshwara College. We are honored and feel deeply indebted to all of you for having agreed to share our moments of pride and joy. We begin our function by lighting the lamp accompanied by an invocation song. May I now request our esteemed guests on the dais to kindly inaugurate the Diamond Jubilee celebrations by lighting the lamp. The invocation song is sung by our student Rishikesh Satyan.
Tanna
on Goddess Saraswati, revered as the Goddess of Learning. I now request a respected principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, Professor C. Sheila Reddy, to kindly deliver the welcome address.
A very good morning to one and all. It is my proud privilege that on the occasion of the Diamond Jubilee celebrations of Sri Venkateshwara College, to accord a warm welcome to our esteemed guests, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, Honorable Minister of State for External Affairs and Minister of State for Culture, who would be joining online in short while, Sri Y.V. Subbareddy, Honorable Chairman, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanam's Trust Board, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, Executive Officer, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, who is already online, Professor P.C. Joshi, Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, who is with us physically and very grateful to him for his physical presence, Professor N.V. Varghis, Honorable Vice Chancellor of National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration. Notwithstanding their busy schedule, I am grateful to the dignitaries for gracing this occasion. I also welcome other distinguished guests, Professor Suman Kundu, Director, South Campus, Professor Balram Pani, Dean Colleges, Dr. A. Shankar Reddy, Padma Shri Awardee, presently Honorary Advisor, TTD Educational Institutions, and former Principal Sri Venkateshwara College, and university representatives on governing body who are always very supportive, Professor Devi Sarkar, Professor Sanjay Kapoor. A very warm welcome to all of you. My greetings and welcome to all the invitees, dear colleagues, alumni, and dear students. The year 1961 will always be fondly remembered and cherished in the annals of Sri Venkateshwara College. It was the spirited vision of Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh, an eminent educationist, Sri K.L. Rao, former Union Minister, and Sri C. Anna Rao, the then Chief Executive Officer of the Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, that translated into reality with Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, an eminent teacher, scholar, and statesman, laying the foundation stone of the college on the 20th August 1961 on a sprawling 15-acre campus at Daulakwa, New Delhi. This marked the beginning of an historical journey of an educational institution that has been successfully nurturing young minds into notable change makers of the society. What began as a small family of 273 students and 13 staff members at Andhra Education Society School Building at Rouse Avenue, Delhi, is today a leading college of University of Delhi with 211 teaching and 105 non-teaching staff. That means the college has been continuously expanding its horizons with initial few pass courses to exhaustive honors courses in all three streams, that is humanities, commerce, and sciences, with 20 vibrant departments. With continuous blessings showered by the Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanam's Trust of Andhra Pradesh, and with the immense support from University of Delhi all these years, the college has carved a niche for itself as a prominent, nationally sought after co-educational institution that is renowned not only for academics, but also for its research ecosystem, sports, and cultural vibrancy. Such a phenomenal growth could be possible due to the relentless efforts of our former principals, Dr. V. Krishnamurthy, Dr. A. Shankar Reddy, Dr. P. Hemalata Reddy, and committed faculty who were instrumental in shaping the destiny of the college and setting high standards. We certainly draw inspiration from them to move forward on this occasion. Throughout its 6 decades of glorious journey, Sri Venkateshwara College has grown from strength to strength. It has sought to combine the goals of academic excellence and integrity with the ideals of diversity, equity, as well as social and environmental consciousness, thereby imparting not just skills to its students, but also ethical and moral values. Our consistent efforts towards imparting quality education for holistic development of students is impossible without the unflinching support and commitment of our teaching and non-teaching staff. With more than 4,000 students on roll, the college offers 20 undergraduate, 9 postgraduate courses, 1 year PG diploma course in molecular and biochemical technology, and several other diploma and certificate courses on intellectual property rights, Ayurvedic biology, entrepreneurship, climate change, food technology, bioinformatics, digital marketing, and data sciences, to name a few, in addition to the foreign languages like German, French, and Spanish. Besides, the college places strong emphasis on physical and mental well-being of our students. To this effect, the college has augmented sports facilities marked by the improved tennis courts as well as upgraded cricket and football fields. In its constant endeavor to mold students into well-rounded individuals of 21st century, the college provides an environment that instills social responsibility among students through several community outreach programs like the National Service Scheme, which inculcates discipline, develops character, and promotes the spirit of camaraderie amongst the youth. The Equal Opportunity Cell champions the cause of students differently abled. Then societies such as Entrepreneurship Cell, Enactus, Women Development Cell, and Echo Club in the college aim to provide an enriching learning experience to the students. Our Fine Arts Society includes a vibrant group of students performing at national and international fora. It gives me immense pleasure to share with all of you that the college has been honored with several awards and accolades, such as Center for Potential for Excellence in 2004 by University Grants Commission, Star College Scheme in 2011, and DBT Star status in 2016 by the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. In 2016, our college was accredited with Grade A in Cycle 1 by the National Assessment and Accreditation Council, and we are now in the process of submission of the self-study report for the second cycle of NAC accreditation. Sri Venkateshwara College has been ranked amongst the top 15 colleges in India in many educational surveys such as MHRD and IRF, India Today, The Week, and Outlook, the latest ranking being ranked 9th in sciences, 6th in humanities, and 13th in commerce, which was released by Outlook magazine in the early weeks of August 2021. Education is not the learning of facts, but the training of the mind to think, to explore students' inquisitiveness, and to keep them abreast with the latest developments in their respective domains. Our exceptional faculty is continuously involved in high-quality research with grants from various funding agencies at both national and international levels. Several national and international conferences, seminars, lecture series, workshops organized by the college boost intellectual engagement with scholars and scientists from both within and outside the country. In the year 2019, the college also initiated a Sri Venkateshwara internship program for promotion of research and academics, that is Sri Vipra, that provides a platform for students to look through beyond curriculum under the mentorship of faculty. It is heartening to note that there has been an overwhelming response, with over 500 students registered for Sri Vipra under 40 faculty members in the year 2021. The academic rigor and efforts of the faculty are reflected in the outstanding results of our students and significant achievements of our notable alumni in both academia and industry, which have added sheen and glory to the college. In the age of globalization and information, the frontiers of exchange and collaborations have also become imperative. The college has signed MOUs, agreements, for academic research and cultural exchange by forging meaningful and long-lasting partnerships. To cite a few are our prestigious associations with Nordic universities in 2018, Martin Luther University, Germany in 2019, Czech University of Life Sciences in 2020, and with corporate giants like Eureka Forbes and Honda Motors for several joint initiatives and endeavors. Maintaining the momentum of quality consciousness is crucial in colleges in the context of higher educational reforms. The internal quality assurance cell of Sri Venkateshwara College has played a crucial role in the development and application of quality benchmarks or parameters for the various academic and administrative activities of the college. The smooth functioning of day-to-day affairs of the college rests on the shoulders of our reliable administration. The services of the establishment, academic, and account section, supervised by administrative officer and section officers, are worthy of appreciation. It is not an exaggeration to state that they are the backbone of the institution. Today, we mark the Diamond Jubilee year, unveiling the statue of our founder and mentor, Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh, an icon of strength, hope, and a symbol of women empowerment. As a part of year-long activities, we have planned series of academic and cultural events. Apart from this, I am glad to share that TTD Trust has given us approval to refurbish our library and facilitate the construction of rainwater harvesting structures in the college. I am thankful to Chairman TTD, Sri Y.V. Subbareddy Garu, and Executive Officer TTD, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy Garu, for their continued support in all our endeavors. We hope to initiate many such things in due course of time. Every journey has its own set of challenges. One such challenge is the unprecedented COVID-19 pandemic, which at one point of time had pushed the world to a grinding halt. The COVID has taken a heavy toll on the lives of few of our beloved family members at Sri Venkateshwara College. Dr. Poorna Chandra Rao, Department of Botany, Dr. Neeraj Sahai, Department of History, Dr. Y.K. Boone, Department of Chemistry, and Mr. Rakesh Bansal, Laboratory at his assistant in the Chemistry Department. We condole the untimely demise of these persons and place on record my deep appreciation for the services rendered by them and pray that the departed souls rest in peace. However, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. We at Sri Venkateshwara College have embraced the impact of the pandemic collectively with resilience and channelized our energies in transforming this limiting circumstance to an opportunity in exploring new avenues of learning and connecting, adapting to the new normal. This has solely become possible through a dynamic and dedicated ICT team in the college. The past 1.5 years has certainly taught us many lessons. Going forward, we should be mindful of the fact that we need to continuously unlearn, learn, and relearn to march ahead triumphantly into the future. The soul of the college lies in its students. Our students brought and are bringing a lot of accolades and laurels, enhancing the name and fame of the college. Dear students, we miss your physical presence, and without you, the college is devoid of vibrancy, cheerfulness, and effervescence. We do hope that things ease up, resuming face-to-face interface in the days to come. I take this opportunity to thank the entire SVC family, the Diamond Jubilee Committee, and the Souvenir Committee for their efforts and valuable inputs in organizing this celebration. And as you all know, to organize such a celebration, we need a lot of planning. So I really thank from my bottom of my heart the entire fraternity of Sri Venkateshwara College for being behind me and encouraging me to go ahead with this celebrations. But for them, this would not have been materialized. My dear staff and students, This is the moment to cherish our rich legacy and move ahead with renewed vigor and enthusiasm to scale greater heights and achieve many more milestones. I feel extremely fortunate and proud to be steering the institution at this important juncture in its journey. Coming together is a beginning, keeping together is progress, and working together is success. My dear colleagues and students, your support is invaluable. Let us grow together to make a difference and create a long-lasting impact for the nation and the society. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam, for the warm welcome address. I'm happy to introduce our next speaker, respected Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, the Executive Officer of the Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams. Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy is a distinguished and able administrator and has contributed immensely to the development of the college. May I now request Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, Executive Officer, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, to address this August gathering.
Thank you. Om Namo Venkateshaya. Am I audible, Madam?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The Chief Guest who is likely to join, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, Honorable Minister for External Affairs and Culture, Sri Vaivi Subbareddy Garu, who is Chairman TTT Trust Board, who will be joining us shortly. He is participating in Varalakshmivratam in the local temple. Professor Pishu Joshi, Vice Chancellor, Delhi University, and Professor N.V. Varghese, Vice Chancellor, NEPA, who are present physically at Delhi College. And Srimati Professor Sheila Reddy, who gave a very warm welcome address, and other distinguished guests participating there, and the students who are there online. I'm happy to participate in this historical occasion of this great college, that is Sri Venkateshwara College, Delhi. And I congratulate the college, Sri Venkateshwara College, University of Delhi, which is celebrating its Diamond Jubilee year. The college is known for its excellence in academics, sports, and overall development of students who have the privilege of studying there. It's known as one of the prestigious institutions where students from across the country vow to take admission. It has always been one of the founding missions of Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanam Trust to have educational institutions that would merge traditional wisdom with progressive streams of knowledge, including technical knowledge. We have unhesitatingly encouraged all opportunities for growth and development in these institutions. Sri Venkateshwara College has over the years emerged as a premier institution among the several institutions being developed and supported by TTT. I therefore feel great pride in being associated with this college, which is completing 60 years of excellence and also existence. It's indeed no mean achievement to be recognized as DPT Star College status, accredited by NAC as A grade college and ranked in top 15 college in MHRD NIRF rankings in year 2020. It's my deepest, and I congratulate all those staff, principal, the staff, faculty, and the advisors who made it possible to this distinguished distinction. It's my deepest wish that college continues to steadily rise in repute as one of the best college in the country. I congratulate the principal, the staff, and the students of the college, and wish them success in all their future endeavors. I thank the parents of the children who have reposed confidence in the college, and I seek their wholesome support to mold the attitudes and aptitudes of our students to face the world with poise and perfection. I pray to Lord Venkateshwara to shower his blessings on all the teachers and staff to enable them to offer their services with zeal and enthusiasm. May the blessing of Lord Venkateshwara be with all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, for your address and for your unstinting support to the institution. I now request the principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, to felicitate Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, Professor P.C. Joshi. The college felicitates the Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, Professor P.C. Joshi, Distinguished Patron of Excellence, for inspiring young minds in the field of higher education. May I now request the principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, to felicitate Honorable Vice Chancellor, National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, Professor N. V. Varghese. The college felicitates the Honorable Vice Chancellor, National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, Professor N. B. Varghese, eminent scholar and renowned educationist, for his pioneering efforts in educational planning and management. We are pleased to have you, sir, and indeed we consider it our proud privilege to have had the opportunity to felicitate you on our 60th anniversary. Professor P.C. Joshi is currently serving as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Delhi. Prior to occupying this prestigious chair, he has served as Professor of Social Anthropology, Department of Anthropology, University of Delhi, Associate Professor and Head, Department of Medical Anthropology, Institute of Human Behavior and Allied Sciences, Delhi, and many other such positions. Professor Joshi's areas of interest include medical anthropology, qualitative research, public health, disaster impact assessment, and the like. An avid teacher and researcher, he has taught a wide variety of subjects ranging from research methodology to anthropology of material culture, and has got many research publications to his credit. Professor Joshi is the recipient of many awards and distinctions and has served in several bodies in varying capacities. I now invite Professor Joshi, Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, to deliver his address.
Honorable Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy, Executive Officer, TTD, who is watching us online, one of the very dynamic principal of my university, Professor C. Sheila Reddy ji, Subha Reddy ji, and Honorable Chief Guest, I am told she had joined, Meenakshi Lekhi ji. Indeed, I would like to welcome you virtually. I would have expected physically to welcome you, but virtually I'm welcoming you to this great university. My colleague, Professor Balram Pani ji, Principal Saab, Reddy Saab, and Devi Sarkar ji, Honorable Member of Governing Body, Professor Suman Kundu ji, of course, my colleague, Vice Chancellor Nipa, Professor N.V. Varghese ji, and all the distinguished guests who are present in this august hall and also watching us online. I think this college has a history of being started by great lady Durgabai Deshmukh. Durgabai Deshmukh has other distinctions also to her credit. Her husband, C.D. Deshmukh, was illustrious vice chancellor and also, many of me, you may be knowing, founder of India International Center as well. Durgabai Deshmukh also started, if I'm not mistaken, Delhi University Women Association, DUWA as we call it, which is one of the very, very vibrant, I think, body doing immense service to the society. So I'm very glad that to learn that this great lady was also instrumental along with Anna Rao and K.L. Rao to start this college. And who else but the great scholar Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan ji to lay the foundation stone. So definitely if there are achievements, I think the achievements, the foundation of those achievements was laid in the very beginning. And I am really, you know, very glad to come to this college, that it has got a very, very distinctive place among the elite colleges of our country. You know, a few months ago, there was some news going on in the newspaper about this college going to Andhra University. Well, that will never happen, you know. This is one of our very prized college. And we are very proud of this college, you know. Only thing is that if this college, and it is also a campus college. Like you have Miranda House, you have St. Stephen's Hindu. It's also a campus college. It is in South Campus. And it is one of the very prominent campus colleges. And we are very, very proud of this college. This college is a very, I would say, holistic college. There is everything that is there in this college. It has got arts, it has got commerce, as well as science. And I think very, very distinguished teachers have been associated with this college. And I think one of the first teacher to join this college is here. And I think, what else, you know, this is the right time to celebrate, to also celebrate his association with this college. So 60 years of excellence, I would say, this college has achieved. And that is something that I have personally, with all my team members, we have got Dean of Colleges, who is extremely busy person, we've got the South Campus Director. We are all here to witness this 60 years of, I would like to call it, use the tagline of University of Delhi, of glorious existence. Of glorious existence, of distinguished achievements that this college has made. You know, the other day, I was going to meet the Honorable Vice President and his secretary, you know, I met his secretary and he said, I'm an alumnus of Sri Venkateswara College. So I feel very proud, you know, I really feel very proud. So it has got, I think, distinguished alumni. You please link to them. Please ask, invite them to join this celebration. This celebration should not be for one day. I think this celebration should continue for the whole year. And you should try to link yourself with your distinguished alumni as well. So As far as the University of Delhi is concerned, we are coming up with a new idea, which is called as academic social responsibility. You know, you have heard of corporate social responsibilities, but I think the time has come when we should talk about, at least discuss and debate, academic social responsibility. And what is our academic social responsibility? You see, we are all very privileged, as I said, that this St. Sri Venkateswara College has got a very, very high ranking. And high ranking they have achieved because of very, very dedicated staff, non-teaching staff, and I think they have made efforts to reach that level. But I think we have now, like Delhi University, similarly this college also has academic social responsibility. And what is that academic social responsibility? That this knowledge, we should try to help those who are not so privileged to have those kind of knowledge that we are having. So therefore, Delhi University has come up with Vidya Vistar. And I'm very glad to share with you that most of our colleges and departments are actively participating in Vidya Vistar and linking themselves with colleges and universities located in remote parts of India. Second academic social responsibility, which is initiated by University of Delhi, is that every student who is going to get admitted in University of Delhi would plant one tree. And not only that he would be or she would be planting one tree, but ped lagao, ped bachao. So till the time the student is there, the student will be monitoring the growth of that tree. And after 3 years, 4 years, depending upon when the student is leaving, the students will have to show as a proof that the tree has been successfully planted. So we wanted to have that also as our academic social responsibilities. Now, there are so many things that I would like to say, but I would not be taking much of your time. But of course, I would also like to join Honorable Principal in paying my deep homage to the, you know, staff that you have lost, four people, very dedicated people that you have lost. And but then, as I say, that is the cruel hand of destiny, and they were beyond our control. I know one of them, Manish Sahai, who was admitted in GTB hospital, and I was monitoring him. We could not save. So that was the, but then I think that second wave of COVID gave us a lesson to better prepare. And I think we are now preparing ourselves better for any eventuality that may happen. So with these words, with these notes of course, sadness also, and we must be, I think, equally concerned about the loss as well as the gains. So we have made many gains, but there are some losses that also made. But I think I would like this college to continue celebrating this 60 years, Diamond Jubilee years, with lots of research, academic, and other programs, sports, another thing, sports, and cultural activities. They should all be part and parcel. This year in Olympics, one of our students took part, Manu Bhakar. Unfortunately, she could not get a medal. But then participation itself, the university's participation, I would like to see one day your college is sending, sports persons to, international events like Olympics. And very, very, I think that would be another milestone in your college. So I wish this college to reach new milestones, to scale new heights, and come within 10 now. You are very near to 10, but I think you should come within 10. So that is my wish, and that is my desire. And I'm very, very confident that this college will fulfill my desire. With these words, I again greet you all and congratulate. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir, for that enlightening address. We look forward to your continued guidance and support. Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi ji is yet to join, so we will proceed with our सेकेंड राउंड ऑफ फेलिसिटेशंस. सहना भवतु सहनो भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विना वधितमस्तु माविद विसावहै. विद दीज वर्ड्स फ्रॉम द उपनिषद्स दैट स्पेल आउट यूनिवर्सल हार्मनी एंड कोऑपरेशन अमंग ऑल टुवर्ड्स द एवोल्यूशन ऑफ शार्पन्ड इंटेलेक्ट वी नाउ प्रोसीड ऑन टू फेलिसिटेट अवर अदर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट. May I request our principal, Professor C. Sheila Reddy, Vice Principal Dr. Venkat Kumar, and Bursar Dr. A. K. Chaudhary to kindly felicitate our guests who are present today on the occasion of our Diamond Jubilee celebrations. I invite Professor Suman Kundu, Director, University of Delhi, South Campus, to kindly accept a token of appreciation. College felicitates the Director, University of Delhi, South Campus, Professor Suman Kundu, committed researcher and administrator, for his continuous guidance towards research in higher education. May I request Professor Balram Pani, Dean of Colleges, University of Delhi, to kindly accept our token of gratitude. Okay, we'll proceed on to the next. May I request Professor D.P. Sarkar, Department of Biochemistry, University representative. Okay. So we're continuing with Professor Balram Pani, Dean of Colleges, University of Delhi, to kindly accept a token of gratitude. The college felicitates the Dean of Colleges, University of Delhi, Professor Balram Pani, distinguished teacher and administrator, for his dedicated management of college affairs. Now I request Professor D.P. Sarkar, Department of Biochemistry, University representative on college governing body, to accept our token of appreciation. College felicitates the University of Delhi representative on college governing body, Professor D.P. Sarkar, leading scientist and accomplished teacher, for his efficient mentoring and support to the college. I invite Professor Sanjay Kapoor, Department of Plant Molecular Biology, University representative on college governing body, to kindly accept a token of appreciation. The college felicitates the University of Delhi representative on college governing body, Professor Sanjay Kapoor, eminent scientist and committed researcher, for his dedicated support to the college. Thank you, Vice Principal Dr. Venkat Kumar and Bursar Dr. A. K. Chaudhary. You may kindly be seated. May I request Honorable Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, Professor P.C. Joshi, to kindly felicitate our guests. We are very pleased to have our dynamic former principal, honorary educational advisor, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams and Padma Shri awardee, Dr. A. Shankara Reddy, amidst us today. Sir, may I request you to kindly accept our token of appreciation. College felicitates the honorary educational advisor Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams and former principal Sri Venkateshwara College Padma Shri Dr. A. Shankara Reddy, distinguished teacher and administrator, for his unwavering and energetic support in shaping the destiny of the college. May I now request retired teacher, Department of Hindi and former Vice Principal, Dr. R. K. Jain, to kindly accept our token of gratitude. College felicitates the former Vice Principal, Sri Venkateshwara College, Sri R. K. Jain, mentor and teacher par excellence, for his dedication and commitment to the college since its inception. Our heartfelt thanks to all our distinguished guests for their continuous support and guidance. But for you, this college would not have achieved the status and the glory that we revel in today. We humbly acknowledge your valuable contributions. May I now request Dr. Padma Shri Dr. A. Shankara Reddy to kindly address this audience.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Delhi University, Professor Joshi, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Varghese of NIPA, respected Principal Dr. C. Sheila Reddy Garu, Vice Principal Dr. Venkat Kumar, the Chairman TTD Devasthanam Sri Y.V. Subbareddy, Dr. K.S. Jawahar Reddy Garu, the Executive Officer. I have been waiting for this occasion for many years. I always believe in Sri Sri Ravi Shankar's famous quote, always, who says, "One must dream in life. Let us dream, you dream. But to realize your dreams, one must put hard work, and that hard work alone can achieve your dreams." When I became a principal, I had no dreams. I started dreaming only the day after I became the principal. Believe me, we have a wonderful colleague with us, Dr. R.K. Jain. I call him as the living fossil of the 1961 batch. Everyone left this world and this institution beyond us, and he has been instrumental in giving me the dreaming projects to me. Dr. Shankar Reddy, sir, if you have something to do for this college, this is the white paper that I have prepared for this institution. God has been kind. In fact, I would say, behind the success of every man, there is a woman. Behind the success of every woman, there would also be a man. But for us in Venkateswara College, behind our success, there is always Lord Venkateswara. You can see in all our activities, even our Jawahar Reddy Garu, behind him, there is Lord Venkateswara and Padmavati there with him. I removed my mask when I was going to get the whatever felicitation they have been honoring, because I have again another belief. I never get contaminated by a friend's circle. So this is the faith that I have in my friends, in my colleagues, administrative colleagues, that I felt boldly and went with all the privilege that I have. Friends, as an advisor, that the privilege of becoming advisor to Tirupati Devasthanams and to this institution is not just because I am Shankar Reddy, I got it. It is because of your contribution and our students' contribution. The faculty, teaching, non-teaching, as you rightly put it, it is your contribution that made this college as one of the most privileged colleges in the country. It is that effort that you brought in. I have been honored to be the advisor to TTD Devasthanams also. Sir, with all the humor that we have in our life, when somebody asked me, Dr. Reddy, here, what is that you do? I said, I am advisor to Lord. See, that is what it is. So the Lord Venkateswara has bestowed that faith in me. And with all these things I have been talking about, you rightly said it, this college cannot go away from this Delhi University. In my advisory role, after becoming the TTD advisor, when the letter from an honorable chief minister had been submitted to the MHRD minister, I have been saying with full faith on you and on us that this college will remain with the Delhi University as one of the colleges as you all dreamt. And also, our next aim would be to make this college as a university by itself according to the new education plan that we have. The best institutions will get that. So, my friends, thank you very much. It is you and we together must progress. We must work together. And I would like to say, I have already requested our Honorable Chairman and Evo Garu, two things I have said. Our auditorium should be full. Two more projects have to come from in this college. That is the campus, that is canteen and other commerce block. So these projects will take it. We will be self-sufficient. Without TTD Devasthanams and Lord blessings, EO and the chairman, we cannot achieve. We request them, we will proceed and pursue them to bring all these things. Thank you very much once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. A. Shankar Reddy, for your kind support and your unstinting support to the institution. I extend a warm welcome to our Honorable Chief Guest, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, Minister of State for External Affairs and Culture, who has joined us online. Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, we are proud to have you amidst us. Proud history, promising future, 60 amazing years of Sri Venkateswara College is what we are celebrating today. As we step on our 60th year, we reflect upon our achievements, our shortcomings, and look up to our future with optimism, with all your support. Respected Sri Meenakshi Lekhi, with your kind permission, may we, on your behalf, proceed on to release an online version of our souvenir.
Please do, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we present to you the preliminary glimpse of the e-version of the 60th year Diamond Jubilee celebration souvenir. The final version in both e-copies and print will be released during the concluding ceremony of our Diamond Jubilee on the 22nd of August 2022. The final edition aims to showcase the celebration of 60 years of our college, including the many activities planned for the current year. Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi is currently serving as the Minister of State for External Affairs and Minister of State for Culture. She has a bachelor's degree from Hindu College and a LLB from the Campus Law Center of the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. As a lawyer, she has practiced in varying capacities in a range of forums and handled a wide variety of issues. She won the high-profile New Delhi parliamentary constituency as a Bharatiya Janata Party candidate in the 2014 elections and was re-elected in 2019. She's a brilliant debater in the parliament, where she has made notable contributions to debates on the Triple Talaq Bill, to name a few. Owing to her laudable contributions, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi has several awards to her credit. Prominent among them is the Best Debut Woman Parliamentarian Award. May I now humbly request Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi to deliver her address.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Principal ma'am, members of the faculty, members of the TTD board, Chairman Mr. Reddy, and Lord Venkateshwara, as the name goes, the piety and the privilege of studying in a college like Sri Venkateshwara brings the future which is bright, and the history obviously is fantastic. And I think that is what is the message of the present time leading us to the future. The country has completed 75th year of independence, and we are entering the 75th year. In this 75th year, the Prime Minister announced that this is called Amrit Kal, because the celebration which started on March 2020, 12th of March, which was the Satyagraha day for Mahatma Gandhi, to the present day, Amrit Mahotsav was announced. And this Amrit Mahotsav, I think, is a time when all of us should go back to our historical backgrounds. And for people of Sri Venkateshwara College, more reasons to celebrate that Kakatiya Temple, called Ramappa Temple, was selected this year for the UNESCO World Site. From art to culture to science, there has been a fluidity of the movement. And this fluidity of the movement across the country is what we need to celebrate in our history and look at what the future has to offer, whether it's from the business perspective or from the creative perspective or from the economic perspective. The sheer strength of our country, which was tested and tested very hard during pandemic, continues to be tested whether on borders or the inside, the internal situations, pandemic itself, from zero manufacturing in terms of PPE kits to the face covers, masks, and N95 to ventilators. We were not producing anything, but when the need arose, each one of us continued to support this program, and India did become Atmanirbhar on many fronts. And the biggest Atmanirbharta which India has shown is production of our vaccines, from Covishield to Covaxin. Imagine a country of 130 crore people and everybody needs double dose, and the international cost of a vaccine is 1800 to 2500 rupees. And if this was going to be the burden which country had to pay and pay for, then one can imagine what would have happened to the middle class household budget and the government of India's budget or the state government's budget. We would be left with no money to do any other activity. But by God's grace, our Prime Minister showed the foresight, and that foresight got our own vaccine. And this Atmanirbharta needs to be sustained on every field. 3,000 crore plus was given to the private companies to start researching and working on manufacture of the vaccine. And earliest you produce, if you succeed, the country will buy those vaccines from you. And the results are for everyone to say. And that is why I say Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas. And Prime Minister's added another quote to it, and that is Sabka Prayas, which means everyone needs to do their share of work. It cannot be just government-led program. The progress of this country can only be successful when everybody contributes to this, to its success, and participates in the progressive programs of the country, schemes, and every other aspect. I would request Sri Venkateshwara College, as the name suggests, will also participate in Amrit Mahotsav. All its activities will be geared towards recommending what the future plan of the country should be and celebrating our rich history. And rich history reminds me that yesterday only in IGNCA, I have inaugurated an exhibition, and that exhibition is of unsung heroes, basically. People think and say that 1857 was the first rebellion, first revolt. People call it rebellion, but we call it the war, the first war of freedom. And from this first war of freedom, actually, many such wars happened during 1756 onwards and before 1857 itself. 1857 was kind of a culmination of all that was going on in the country. And people like weavers, people who worked on silk, people who produced salt, the people who produced saltpeter, the people who were sannyasis, people who were living in the jungles, the Adivasis, everyone worked together. And sometimes, even if they didn't work together, these were the people who were fighting against the imperialism and also working for self-determination by our country. And when people say India was born in 1857 because of the Britisher, I will just quote one shloka from Vishnu Puran, and which says, uttaram cha samudrasya himadrascha dakshinam tatra bhumi nama bharata bharati cha santati cha bharati, which means on the north of the sea and south of the Himalayas, the land which is there is called Bharat, and this Bharat Bhumi's children are called Bharati. That means the concept of a country, it was very much there. India as Bharat was very much there. The only thing could be that political alignment could be very different, and from time to time, from Rajendra Chola to several other dynasties would have worked across the country, but the country was very much a very, very valid context in terms of civilizational value system. And what we are seeing today all across is that we are the children of Yodhas who fought for the survival of this country, who fought for the survival of our civilization, who fought for the survival of our culture, who fought for the civilization of our language. And this is what we call freedom. Let us all celebrate Amrit Mahotsav, be part of this movement, and let's work together. My wishes to everyone. My request to all the youngsters who have joined online and who are present there and led by their faculty, you should visit IGNCA and visit your monuments, visit your museums on the weekends or whenever opportunity arises. Let's spend our time in gaining knowledge about our own country, and let's take this movement forward to every household, to every individual. Be proud of our history and make the future better. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, for that enlightening address. Indeed, it is Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas, and Sabka Prayas, which is going to help us attain an Atmanirbhar Bharat. As always, we feel indebted to you for having taken time off from your busy schedule to be a part of our function. We genuinely appreciate your gracious presence and look forward to having you more often.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. We now move forward to our next item in the agenda, the Durgabai Deshmukh Memorial Lecture by Professor N.V. Verghese. Professor N.V. Verghese is currently serving as the Vice Chancellor of National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, New Delhi. He is also the founding director of Center for Policy Research in Higher Education. He holds a doctoral degree in economics with specialization in educational planning. He has served as the head of governance and management in education at the International Institute for Educational Planning, Paris. In the 1990s, Professor Verghese has served as head of the educational planning unit at NIPA, New Delhi. In this capacity, he has been closely associated with educational planning at the federal and decentralized levels and with the design and development of externally funded education projects in India. While in NIPA, he has also been responsible for managing the Asian Network of Training and Research. May I now request Professor N.V. Verghese to kindly address the audience.
Thank you very much for this long introduction. Honorable Minister, Madam Meenakshi Lekhi, respected Jawahar Reddy, Executive Officer, TTD, Joshi Saab, Madam Principal, Vice Principal, Reddy Saab, and many other dignitaries. I do not know the names of all of you. And especially the teachers and the students who are present here and attending this function remotely. It's a great privilege, a proud privilege, and a great honor to get an opportunity to deliver the lecture in memoriam of Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh. As it was pointed out by Professor Joshi, she and her husband were very renowned, not only in the education field, in framing, in designing many policy matters and also many programs, social development programs in this country. So it's certainly for me, a person of my stature, to be invited to deliver the lecture, I consider it to be a great honor. Friends, I am requested to talk on higher education. I'll talk on higher education for the next 25 minutes. I will say that today, if you are talking about higher education development in this country, it has to be contextualized in the context of the new education policy. What it says, any policy is an aspiration and an ambition, and therefore it has to be contextualized to that level. Therefore, when we look into the way forward in higher education, we have to base it on the basis of the propositions and the recommendations which are made in the policy. I'll come to it towards the end of my presentation, but let me start by saying that the major change that you find in higher education system is that in the 20th century, education was a publicly provided service or good or investment. That means public education was the characteristics of educational development in the world and in this country. Today, in the 21st century, higher education especially is a privately provided good. When I say this, 78% of the institutions and 66% of the students are in the private sector today in India. So therefore, there's a dramatic change that has taken place in the travels that you have made, in the transition that you have made, and the progress that you have made. But at the same time, there are two intervening factors that are important. One is what is called as a globalization. With the death or with the disappearance of the Soviet Union and also the socialist patterns, market has become the homogenizing factor of development in the world. And this has its implications from 1991 onwards in India too. And this is reflected, these economic reforms are also reflected in the context of educational development and especially higher education development. And therefore, a dramatic change that has taken place. Today, the debate on higher education is centered around two issues. One is, should the universities develop critical thinking, or should the universities teach practical things? This is the debate. And this is a great debate. It's not a debate on the words. Because knowledge has two dimensions. Knowledge has knowing and knowledge has operation. What the university should do, what the university should not do, it centers around, if you consider that knowledge as knowing, it has a different meaning. On the other hand, if you say that knowledge as operation, it has a different meaning. Because industries want universities to be the production centers for manpower for their units. Is that the purpose of universities? Is that we try to embark upon? Is that we try to encourage? Is that we want to propagate as the basic function of the universities? Employment orientation is different. But should the universities be subjugated, or should the university be made subsectors or an extension of the industrial complexes that we find? Or universities, whether the universities have other role? That's the point that I want to say, that knowledge as knowing and knowledge as operation. That's a debate in education. That's a debate in the development of higher education in this country. Universities have traditionally been functioning, having two functions. One, produce knowledge and transact knowledge. Sorry.
Our chairman is on the line. If you can take a break of 2 minutes, I think we can order
him. Okay, please.
Is it okay?
Do it.
I'll let him continue. Okay.
You continue.
Okay. So, what I was trying to say is that there are two dimensions of any university at any point of time. One is producing knowledge, second one is the transacting knowledge. Universities at all times try to do this. The only difference is that to whom knowledge is produced and to whom knowledge is transacted. That varied over a period of time. When you talk in terms of equity, if you talk in terms of quality, if you talk in terms of the transactory powers,
all this center around these two dominant functions. We had developmental universities. And if you see the development of universities in the most of the developing countries, especially in the post-development period or post-liberation period, what one finds is that it was a public-centered, it was public-funded, public-sponsored, and public-managed system. If you see in India, immediately after independence in the early 50s, we publicized, publicized, if there is a word like that, the private institutions of higher education. And all the development of the higher education system in this country was determined, decided, influenced by the public sector, its capacity to invest, its capacity to expand. And if you see that, the first education commission in India was on higher education, not on primary education, not on secondary education. The second commission was on secondary education, and the third commission included all levels of education, what we call as the Kothari Commission. So this has undergone a dramatic change over a period of time, the way we try to do that. And all the commissions try to see that. What is important is that I mentioned about knowledge production. But knowledge production, when we started universities, was not part of the university sector. In Indian history, what one finds is that neither teaching nor research was part of universities. Three universities which were established in 1857, in Calcutta, Bombay, and Madras, now Chennai. The universities did not teach, the universities did not do research. They were mostly certifying organizations. Teaching used to take place in the colleges, and research was totally unknown in higher education. Because I started by saying that two functions that the universities are doing, one is knowledge production, other is knowledge transaction. So in India, when we started, there was no knowledge production, only transaction. And that knowledge was produced somewhere else. So we continued that. These were certifying agencies. It was in 907, we find that Ashutosh Mukherjee, who was the Vice Chancellor of Calcutta University, in his famous presidential address, said that universities engage itself with knowledge production. That is how research started in Indian universities, and that is from that time onwards, like great minds like C.V. Raman, Bose, and others who were brought to Calcutta University and started the progress of research. So what we find today is this. Today the debate is, when we talk about knowledge production, who is going to be benefited? It is also a part that you are discussing, that who is getting benefit out of the knowledge production that is taking place. And if you see, knowledge production was a public sector activity. And during the Cold War period, if you see that the public sector invested, whether in United States or in Soviet Union, it was the state sector which promoted and produced. Why I'm making this point is that knowledge production was more centered around the defense activities. Technological development was more centered around the defense activities in the countries. And since Soviet Union and United States were the two dominant forces competing each other at that point of time, their investment pattern was that. If you read to 1961, the State of the Union address by Kennedy, the first State of the Union address by Kennedy, the whole focus was on scientific investment, technical innovation to compete with the Soviet Union. It was in 1959 that Yuri Gagarin first landed in Moon. So that was an eye-opener to the whole world in terms of the scientific revolution that can be created, or in terms of the knowledge that can be produced through the universities and through the higher education institutions in the world. So therefore, what we find is that research was added as one of the functions. Research was added as one of the important dimensions. Today, research has become a major function. The universities are decided. And the committees and commissions of higher education in India, what they try to do is a division of labor that was created. Colleges still teach, universities do research, or research institutions. Even today, 80% of the enrollment are in the undergraduate classes. 7 to 8% are in the certificate courses. 11% in the master's courses. And 0.45% for the doctoral and PhD You can see that how the pyramid is getting developed, and knowledge production becomes narrower and narrower and narrower down as we move up. This is the way the knowledge production is created in the country. But the basic difference is that previously, as I mentioned, only the public sector was responsible for knowledge production. Now we find two types of changes. One type of change, the corporate sector got interested in knowledge production. And this is especially after the 1990s, when you find that knowledge itself has become a profitable investment. And your capacity and the company's capacity to compete nationally and internationally depends upon the knowledge capital that you have, not the human capital, which is not knowledge intensive. This dramatically changed our attitude towards universities. This dramatically changed our attitude towards the knowledge production process and the knowledge distribution processes. Why I'm making this point is that Venkateswara University is one of the exceptional cases where you find colleges encouraging research, doctoral studies, and the teachers engaged in research, knowledge production. Whereas majority of the colleges, madam, in the country are mostly engaged in the knowledge transaction processes. This is a unique feature. Today, when we talk about the new education policy, NEP 2020, talks about research universities, teaching universities, and autonomous colleges. When you talk about that, we are trying to focus more and more on the research universities, because the knowledge production has become the defining feature of global ranking. So, for example, we have debates here saying that Indian universities are not appearing the top ranking as top ranking institutions in the global ranking, not in the first 100, not even in the first 200s, you know, this is not happening. Whereas China, which was lagging behind us in many respects in higher education, the tallest, the top ranked university from Asia, number 22, is Peking University in China. And if you take BRICS rankings, if you take into account, if you consider 10 top ranking BRICS universities, 6 are in China. So therefore, there are examples of fast tracking the process of knowledge production that is taking place in many of the universities and the laboratories. So the question is, how do we define the role of universities? How do you refine the role of knowledge? Knowledge as knowing, knowledge as operationalism. How do you make this distinction? Because the major criticism that is put against higher education system is that higher education produces unemployables. My point is that higher education cannot produce employables, because 47% of the employment that we know today will disappear in the next 15 to 20 years. So you produce employables to you for which job? So what is the skill that you are talking about that is to be promoted in higher education? Is it the skills, the skill development, or the on-the-job specific skill formation is not a responsibility of the universities? That's a responsibility of the employer. We should develop general skills, transferable skills. We should develop skills to pick up skills. We should have a capacity to define these skills more commonly than the job-specific skills which the employers or perhaps the industries or the corporate sector is asking for. My point is that universities should have the freedom to think. That's why mentioned about the critical thinking, which becomes one of the important dimensions of the universities. One of the trend that we find in the last 20 years in India is that in the first 50 years of planned development from 1951 to 2000, what we find is that the gross enrollment ratio, that is a share of students or youth in the age group of 18 to 23 going to the college, was single digit, it was only 8%. And the total number of students was only 8.3 million in the first 50 years. In the last 19 years, what we find is that the total number of children or the youth going to the college has gone up to 37.4 million. And the gross enrollment ratio, the share of children going, the age group going to the colleges has gone up to 27.3. That means more than 3 times increase in terms of the gross enrollment ratio and more than 4.5 times increase in terms of the number of students going to this We are second largest education, higher education system in the world after China. We have surpassed United States in the first decade of the present century. So we have massified higher education system. So we are dealing with a mass higher education system. And the challenge that we have, how did the massification affect equity dimensions, equality dimensions, quality dimensions, how it affect the knowledge production process? So let me spend the next 5 minutes on these three aspects of knowledge production that is taking place in the country. First, if you look at, we never considered that private sector will be playing such a dominant role in higher education. It used to play a dominant role in school education, but never. But what has happened is that a unique feature from the 1980s onwards, since I am standing on a platform in Venkateshwara, it is in the Venkateshwara College, it is in Andhra Pradesh, one of the important dimensions of privatization of technical education started. More than 90% of the engineering colleges in Andhra Pradesh, undivided Andhra Pradesh, now Andhra Pradesh and in Telangana, both the states, what you find is technical education is in the private. If you see Karnataka, if you see Puducherry, if you see Tamil Nadu, you find this trend. What we used to call in the 1990s are the capitation fee colleges. But at that point of time, the private institutions did not have the authority to decide what is to be taught, conduct examinations, and award degrees, because private universities were not permitted. Even a bill for the private universities, which was presented in 1995 in the Indian Parliament, could not get passed. So it lapsed. It was in 2002 onwards, many state governments started private universities. And today the division that you find, sarcastically and in a light-hearted manner, if I say that the southern parts of the country, you find private colleges dominating the scene, and the northern part of the country, you will find northern states which did not have private colleges to that extent, you find universities. So what you find as an educational revolution that is taking place in terms of the extension and expansion that is taking place in higher education is a product of the market processes. This is a dramatic change from the design of development that we had in the 1950s, the model of development that he propagated, or when we say that education has become a trade, a commodity to be traded in the market. This has a lot of implications. Say, for example, if you take a state like Telangana, or for that matter Andhra Pradesh, or for that matter Puducherry, you find that there are 50 to 55 colleges per 1 lakh population. But if you go to Bihar, which did not permit so much of private colleges, or Bengal, what you find is only 12 colleges per lakh population, or 13 colleges, or less than 20 colleges. So what is happening is that this massification that you talk about, the market-led massification that you are talking about, the market-mediated process of higher education development in this country has led to increasing inequalities regionally. A second type of inequality that has been widened, even when the system is getting massified, is the question of economic inequalities, which means that if I talk in terms of the quantile, the highest 20% population and the lowest 20% population, the share of students coming from the lowest 20% or 40% of the income levels have declined over a period of time. That is also because this massification is propelled by market, where many poor families and families with lower incomes cannot afford. So the second dimension that I am talking about is that you find that the economic inequalities are widened within education. I'm talking about within higher education. And you find that the inequalities in terms of regions are widened. If you take gender, this is a place where you find that inequalities, at least in access, has declined. You find that in most of the cases, in most of the states where enrollment, gross enrollment ratio is more than 30 or 35%, you find that there are more girls in the colleges than boys, you know. You take Chandigarh, you take Kerala, you take many other states where it is progressing faster, you find a trend which is very different. A fourth dimension of this development is the social inequalities that he talk about, scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, etc. What is less understood is that in the whole process of development and the progress and the faster progress that the sector has made, the biggest beneficiaries are what we call in Indian context as the other backward classes. They increased their share substantially. That is not the case with SC and especially about STs. They also progressed. So in other words, what I mean to say is that unlike the economic and regional changes that you are talking about, here what I am talking about is that everybody benefited, but the rate at which they benefited or the rate at which they progressed varied substantially. And as a result of that, this inter-group variations have increased in India. Not because people did not progress, but because the rate of progress that we find was very, very substantial and very, very different, you know. So the major challenge for India, two in higher education. One, how do we manage markets and massification in higher education? What do I mean by that? If the system has to expand, the private sector has come in a big way. But how do we make the private sector more affordable? How do we make the private sector more responsible? I'm not talking about corporate social responsibility. I'm talking about how the private sector will be made more socially responsible. Or in other words, I put it differently that what we find is that there is a, we introduced market-friendly reforms, especially from 1990s. But the markets are not become people-friendly. So the challenge is, how do we make markets people-friendly in higher education? That is a challenge. That is one challenge that we have. The second challenge, if you are talking about Indian higher education, Indian students are highly respected abroad. Indian professors are also highly respected, but not Indian institutions. It's an irony. And if you see spelling competition that is taking place in the United States, every year the competition is between Indian students, not between Indian and American students. It is between Indian students, which Indian student will be winning. And if you take many of the top ranking students in the top ranking universities in the world, you find that very often you find Indian students doing very well. Similarly, Indian professors, some of the Indian professors who left the country also got Nobel Prizes. Some of them are still alive. So you find that we have such a ecology of knowledge production and research that has been created, but unfortunately, Indian institutions are not respected. So the challenge number two is that how do we improve the image of Indian higher education institutions, and how do we improve this? This challenge is in terms of improving the image so that we can compete with the students or compete with the institutions of this variety abroad. Now let me, that is related to the issues of quality. We have established NAC, and madam mentioned about you are very well doing university or institution within the NAC framework. You have got A plus?
A.
You have got A, and that's a very good score and continues like that. But you know that only 33% or less than one third of the universities and less than 20% of the higher education institutions and colleges are accredited today. So which means that how does it affect whether we have a NAC? NAC is in existence for 27 years. It established in 1994. Today it is 2021. So 27 years, but we have tried to accredit only less than 20% of the institutions. This is very important because the new education policy talks about an alternative mechanism for accreditation arrangements. So this is a important question. This is an important question when we try to see that why the institutions are not performing. UGC said that, stipulated that unless you are NAC accredited, you will not get funding. But what is not recognized is that it has very little effect. Out of 41,000 colleges in this country, only 11,500 colleges are getting UGC funding. So how does 25% colleges getting UGC funding, and if UGC makes a stipulation, how can this affect the overall quality of the institution? This is not understood very clearly. Many a time in the public debates, these issues are not coming up on an empirical basis. How does this is going to affect our system? So therefore, the issue is more related to how do we change qualities. That is where the institutional arrangement. That's why we move from accreditation to internal quality assurance. I saw the board in internal quality assurance. I know that in Venkateshwara College it is very active. Because, you know, the Inspector Raj could not improve educational qualification in the schools, because the inspector comes only once a year. The accreditation takes place only once in 5 years. Once you are you got a license, it's like a car license, you know, driving license. If you got a license, then the renewal is only after 5 years. Within 5 years, you can do whatever you want to do. But the next renewal of the license comes, you should be more careful about it, you know. So the internal quality assurance, unless the internal quality assurance cells are developed, systematically monitored, and they do a very good job in terms of not finding fault, but in terms of a supportive environment to make an assessment and make arrangements for improvement at the school level, at the department level, or at the classroom level, I don't think that we'll be in a position to move ahead with these arrangements. Friends, let me take the third part of what I wanted to speak, that is on education policy. Our education policy, as I mentioned, any education policy is an inspiration or is an aspiration where the country wants to go. Our policy is also not different from that. We are getting an education policy after 34 years. What does this policy say? In 1968 policy and 86 policy, we said that higher education should not expand. You might have heard about something like de-link degrees from jobs. That was the understanding in 1986 when we said that why too many students are coming to the colleges? Because the degrees are linked to the jobs. And if you find that after that 1986 policy, there are many things that are happening. Say, for example, if you want to become a lecturer, you have to pass NET. Because you are certified by the same university that you have got a first class. But when you go for a lecture post, university says that we will not accept it unless you go through a competition. If you go to the bank selection, degree will not do. You have to appear for a bank test separately. If you go to IAS, to become IAS, previously there were only two tests, one main examination and another interviews. Today prelims, main, then finally. Or in other words, what I am trying to say is that higher education has become, instead of knowledge protection, a screening device whereby more students can be screened out, more graduates can be screened out rather than in. So the question is that what filter we will use to see that we create barriers to entry. So education becomes, rather than an opportunity to get jobs, education becomes creating barriers to entry. What barriers will create? So that is the changing role of higher education that we practice, that we find today. It is developing as a social screening device to distribute facilities and opportunities in a different way. And you find that there is a social reproduction that is taking place when you analyze the employment opportunities and the jobs that one is getting. So 1986 policy, what was the unwritten rule of educational development in the 1968 policy and the 86 policy? Universalize primary education, expand secondary education, consolidate higher education. Consolidate, don't expand. This is the first policy that has dramatically changed that position by saying that higher education should expand. What did it say? It says that by 2035, we should universalize higher education. It policy talks about 50% enrollment in higher education, which means the definition of universalization of higher education. So this is the first policy that talks about universalization of higher education. But don't mistake, it is not through the public institutions that you will be universalizing. We have been relying on the private institution, and we'll continue to rely on the private institutions. But when it comes to the policy dimensions and the framework of development that you'll try to provide, that will be provided by the public bodies and public institutions. There's a dramatic change that will be introduced in terms of the organization of higher education in this country is concerned. There'll be research universities, there'll be mostly teaching universities, and there'll be autonomous colleges. And there is what is called as institutional consolidation. Multidisciplinary research universities, MERU, that becomes one of the important dimensions, which means that the policy considers that each college should have at least 3,000 enrollment, which is not an easy task. There are 2,600 colleges in India where the enrollment is less than 100. There are 14,500 colleges where the enrollment is less than 500. There are only 4% of the colleges in this country where the enrollment is more than 3,000. There is another 4% in the colleges where the enrollment is between 2,000 and 3,000. So what you have put is a very, very gigantic target to be achieved. What is the solution for quality improvement that you are talking about? So instead of having a NAC as a centralized body to accredit, there will be state level or regional level accreditation bodies. There are state councils of higher education that are existing. The first in the country to establish a national state, national higher education council in 1988 was Andhra Pradesh. This was a recommendation of the 1986 policy. The second one was Tamil Nadu, and the third one was Karnataka. So the state councils of higher education are in existence in most of the states. Many of the state councils of higher education, maybe, I'm underlining maybe, this is a perception that we have and what we have mentioned to the ministry. There is a possibility that they may become accreditation agencies if they are strengthened. And there will be a meta-accreditation agency. Those who are familiar with the United States accreditation process, there is something called Council for Higher Education Accreditation, CHEA, located in Washington. But that is an accreditation agency accrediting the accreditors. They are not directly accrediting any university. There are 45 or 46 accreditation agencies existing, public and private, in the United States. But the CHEA, they should be a member of the CHEA. Then only their accreditation will have a value. Similarly, in India, we will find an accreditation arrangement whereby most of the states will be having their own accreditation agencies, but they will have validity unless the license is given by what we call as a National Accreditation Council, not NAAC, but NAC, that will be, and we do not know how this will take place. Secondly, a substantial change in terms of management. There are four verticals for management. Funding is different. Governance is different. Issues, regulations are different. Then the study programs and their content and curriculum, they are different. So, and accreditation, this is also different. So you find substantially there. I'll end by saying that the future development of higher education in this country, within the context of the regulatory arrangements and the new policy that you are talking about, and if you look into the past, the historical development in higher education that has taken place will depend upon four elements. Our Honorable Prime Minister, while speaking on higher education policy, education policy, mentioned two of them. One, we have ABC, Academic Bank of Credits. That introduces a lot of flexibility to the system. Then there is something called credit transfer system. The ministry appointed a committee, credit transfer system. I was the member secretary of the committee, and NEPA was the secretary for the committee. We submitted our report, so I cannot go into the details what the report contains. But I can say that that is something that will facilitate mobility of students. In the same university, from different departments you can acquire. And you can register in Venkateshwara College University, and you can get from the Padmavati University part of the courses done, or you can do it in Hyderabad University and get your degree. The only condition that is put is that if Venkateshwara University is going to award you the degree, at least 50% of the credit should be acquired from the Venkateshwara University. This is a system that is existing in the open learning systems in India. So this is the second dimension. A third dimension is that National Higher Education Qualification Framework. Assessment of higher education should not be based on the years or time or duration that is spent for studies, but it is to be based on the skills that are acquired. And skill acquisition should not be based on the assessment of the skills per se. What are the competencies that the skills, the difference between skill and competency is that skill is that you train somebody for, competency is that you acquire as a result of the skills that you possess. So it is a competency-based arrangement that you are talking about. And the fourth and last one is the Global Convention of Recognition of Degrees. UNESCO has already in 2019 approved this global convention. India has to ratify it. India has to ratify the regional convention of degree recognition, which was also done in 2012 in Tokyo. That also not yet ratified. So friends, my point is that the future development of higher education, as I mentioned earlier, the debate between be critical and be practical, knowledge as knowing and knowledge as operation, that will continue. I don't think that there will be an end to that. And that's a good debate that we should continue to place knowledge production and to place knowledge transaction in two separate but not separate baskets which cannot be mixed, in a mixture whereby the emphasis that is added will be very different by institutions. Venkateswara College may give one proportion, whereas St. Stephen's College in Delhi University may give it in another proportion, you know. So that will continue. Secondly, how do we improve the academic credibility and visibility and status of institutions of education, higher education? And the third one, that will be that how do we manage markets and massification of higher education? It is not a question of stopping, but how do we do that? And ultimately, the quality issue that I mentioned will become and will decide, will influence the growth and development and progress of higher education in this country. Thank you very much for a patient listening.
Thank you very much, sir, for an interesting and engaging lecture. Indeed, we have shifted from a socially or public-oriented frame to a neoliberal frame, and education is no exception. Probably Sain's human capabilities frame would have been better suited to our context, but nevertheless, as you rightly said, whether we emphasize on learning outcomes or on learning is the current debate that we seem to be grappling with. Thank you again, sir. Sri Venkateswara College, popularly known as Venki, is what it is because of its students. Unfortunately, because of the pandemic, our students have not been able to join us physically. We miss them and they miss college. We have many clubs and societies that bring out the creative potentials of our students in the liberal and performing arts. Here is a small musical fusion presentation by the students of Sri Venkateswara College titled as Shades of Yaman. Thank you. Thank you, Ayushi Banafar, Aditi Dobriyal, Ananya Kapoor, Anushka Garg, Rishikesh Satyan, Niyati Vashishta, Gopika G.S., Monya Sundarshanam, Radhika Dikshit, Maruf Ali Khan, Pranav Mathur, Vaishnav M.R. and Yashkrit Singh for this wonderful composition. We are so proud of you. I, on behalf of the Sri Venkateshwara family, now extend a warm welcome to our esteemed chairman, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanam's Sri Y.B. Subbareddy Garu. Sir, we are extremely pleased to have you with us. May I request our honorable chairman, a multifaceted personality, to deliver his address on this happy occasion of our Diamond Jubilee celebrations.
Namaskar. Namaskar. Om Namo Venkateshaya. I welcome Honorable Chief Guest Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi Ji, Honorable Minister for External Affairs and Culture, and Professor V.C. Joshi Ji, Vice Chancellor, and N.V. Varghese, Vice Chancellor, and our EO, TTD EO, Dr. Jawahar Reddy Garu, and additional EO, Dharma Reddy Garu, and Professor Sheila Reddy, and all other dignitaries and professors, and my dear students. I congratulate the fraternity of Venkateshwara College on the occasion of the Diamond Jubilee. The college set up in the year 1961 under the benevolent aegis of Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams with the dynamic vision of founding the members has established itself as one of the leading institutions of the country, manifesting indigenous ethos and spirit of pluralism. The college offers progressive education and broad spectrum of development to the youth of the country and continues to hold the torch of illumination in the 16th year, giving shape to ideas and fostering innovation. It's a matter of great pride that Sri Venkateshwara College is nurturing generations of highly competent, empathetic, and skilled students who have adorned diverse careers and professions with utmost commitment. We are thankful to the Distinguished Vice Chancellor, University of Delhi, for all his support to the college. The Diamond Jubilee year comes at a time when the college, having risen from the challenges and hardships posed by the pandemic, has maximized its efforts to keep pace with the changing times. We have a long journey ahead of us, and I wish that the college keeps on growing from strength to strength. And my best wishes to the staff and students of Sri Venkata College. All the best. God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind support and for gracing the Diamond Jubilee celebrations.
Thank you.
I now request...
My turn, please.
I now request an audiovisual on the history of college to be played.
The desire to share knowledge and the dream to make education accessible to all brought together three visionaries, Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh, Shri K.L. Rao and Shri C. Anna Rao in the early decades of India's independence. Along with Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams, they saw a vision to create an institution that blends traditional values and learning with modern outlook and rationale in the heart of our country. Today, Sri Venkateshwara College finds itself as one of the brightest stars of the University of Delhi. Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan laid the foundation stone of the college 60 years ago, and from then began the journey that saw the college shape sensitive and balanced global citizens of tomorrow. And to this day, the college has relentlessly pursued the ideals set by the founders and taken pride in creating a holistic learning atmosphere for students from diverse backgrounds at a minimal cost. Wenkiites love to exhibit their art and athleticism through dynamic cultural societies and a competitive sporting culture. As we move ahead after completing 60 glorious years of academic excellence, Sri Venkateshwara College humbly embraces its proud history and promising future.
Request our former vice principal and retired teacher, Department of Hindi, Dr. R. K. Jain, to kindly address the audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, I will take only 2 minutes. I thank all the college authorities for my felicitation. I take it as not only for me, but for all the first batch of teachers of this college, whom I represent today by the grace of God. I would like to speak a few words about the great lady, Dr. Durga Bai Deshmukh. 60 years ago, when I joined this college, sir, I was only 21 years old. I had the great honor of listening to that great lady, Dr. Durga Bai Ji Deshmukh, in the college hall in the very first year, 1961, and for many more years. She was a very simple lady, used to come to the college in a very simple cotton sari. But she was a great lady with great visions and an iron will. This college was her emotional child. She used to become very sentimental, talking about how she was able to establish this college with the help of TTD Devasthanams. While speaking about the efforts she had taken regarding establishing this college, even tears used to come to her eyes. That shows how deeply she loved this college. I am very grateful to Lord Venkateshwara that he permitted me to serve this college for 45 long years, from 1961 to 2006, when I retired. I won't take much of your time. I wish Lord Venkateshwara to bless us all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a pleasure listening to you after a long, long time. शं नो मित्रः शं वरुणः शं नो भवत्वरयमां शं नो इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शं नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि हृतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारंगवतु अवतु मांग अवतु वक्तारंग ओम शांति शांति शांति. विद दीज वर्सेस फ्रॉम द ऋग्वेदा दैट प्रोपेल अस टू सरेंडर आवरसेल्व्स टू नथिंग बट द ट्रूथ वी ब्रिंग today's inaugural Diamond Jubilee celebrations of this great institution, Sri Venkateshwara College, to a close. Proud history, grand present, promising future. May I now request the Vice Principal, Dr. Venkat Kumar, to kindly deliver a vote of thanks.
Friends, today I stand before you with a great sense of pride on this occasion of celebrating our college 60 years of glorious journey. By firstly remembering those three great visionaries who dreamt and put on ground our prestigious institution. Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh, the freedom fighter, who fought for women's rights and who was also the founder of Andhra Mahila Sabha, first chairperson of the present-day National Commission for Women, and who also laid the path for creation of Welfare Board for Weaker Section. Sri K.L. Rao, a technocrat politician, who also was the architect of the Nagarjuna Sagar project. Sri C. Anna Rao, the then executive officer TTD, who was acclaimed and remembered by many of us as the institution builder. We, the management, staff, and students are immensely grateful to these three visionaries and place on record our infinite pranams to them. We are greatly honored to have the Honorable Minister of State, Srimati Meenakshi Lekhi, an eminent advocate for readily accepting our invitation as chief guest and for her enthusing speech. The success story of our college is due to the mutual respect exhibited over the years between University of Delhi and our management, Tirumala Tirupati Devasthanams. This spirit is still continued. I am extremely delighted to convey our heartfelt gratitudes to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor P.C. Joshi, who with his dynamic team of university officials, Professor Suman Kundu, Director, University of Delhi South Campus, Professor Balram Pani, Dean Colleges, Dr. Vikas Gupta, always had affectionate consideration to our college. Today, we are privileged to have them in our midst and thankful to them with their blessings for our march towards excellence. In this context, I just cannot stop from expressing my gratitude, though they are part of our family, this management, to recall the encouragement Professor Devi Sakkar and Sanjay Kapoor has been to this institution. The college is greatly honored to have the support and the guidance of our chairman, Sri Y.V. Subba Reddy Garu, executive officer, Dr. K.S. Jawar Reddy Garu, and Sri O. Balaji, the FA and CAO, who is also the treasurer of our college. It is always their wisdom and words of encouragement which encouraged us to look beyond horizon in search of opportunities for growth and excellence. We, the staff and students, place on record our heartfelt gratitudes to you all and your team of Srimati Bhargavi, the Joint Executive Officer Education, and Sri Govindarajan, the Devasthan Educational Officer, for providing us the necessary support. Today we have amongst us an education expert, Professor N.V. Varghese, who has readily accepted our request to deliver keynote lecture in marking our determination to begin the annual Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh lecture, to be conducted henceforth every year on this foundation day of our college. Sir, your in-depth knowledge on issues relating to higher education and the curriculum building would always be remembered for its insightful, inclusive education to all, and there could not have been a better tribute to Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh with your participation in today's event. We are very much thankful for your presence and for delivering the keynote lecture. An institution celebrating its 60 years would always be joyous to remember their captains. I mean it, and this is how it is to be looked into, who have been the seat of administration. I am greatly honored to have worked under three of the principals, late Dr. V. Krishnamurthy, who built the quality academic structure of our college by introducing the honors courses in our college. Padma Shri Dr. A. Shankar Reddy, who I always remember as an excellent administrator. He added the colors to our college academics through holistic development of our students, through excellent mix of academics with sports and extracurricular activities. Sir, we greatly remember your contribution to development of college infrastructure, the new academic block, library building expansion, sports ground development, hostel, new faculty flats are a few to name. Dr. P. Hemlata Reddy, who has been a source of encouragement to many of our colleagues in the conduct of research through various projects funded by multiple agencies, including Delhi University's innovation projects. Madam, the spirit still continues. We are also grateful to our first and second principals, Sri Y.V. Ramana and Sri B.L. Rao, for being the catalyst in making the college to have this brilliant takeoff. I am personally thankful to Professor C. Sheila Reddy, the present principal, for having graciously accepted our suggestions and for appreciating the efforts of every staff in the launch of this event of today. I am also thankful to my co-members on the core committee, the souvenir committee, the TICs, staff, teaching and non-teaching. My special thanks are to those students who have helped us in the making of an AV on our college, the Finance Association students and all other students and alumni who have joined us on Zoom and YouTube. We are also thankful to all the principals of our sister institutions who have joined us on Zoom to celebrate our happiness. Last but not the least, my special thanks and gratitudes to my two colleagues, Dr. Padma Suresh and Padma Priyadarshini, if I have to say the Padma Dio, for planning the conduct of today's event so meticulously, and Sri Syamal Rao, PA to Principal, for coordinating with the Minister's Office, Mr. Murthy, for Senior Assistant, and our former colleague, Dr. V.C. Rao, for making the installation of the bust of Srimati Durgabai Deshmukh happen. Any virtual event is incomplete without the technical assistance of our ICT team. Mr. Naveen, Mr. Kuldeep, and Mr. Narendra Bharadwaj are worthy for appreciation. I am greatly thankful to my colleague and friend, Dr. Anunay, bursar of the college, for positively accepting our budgetary proposals made by the core committee for this year-long activities. To err is human, and forgetfulness is an outcome of aging. I am no exception. I seek pardon if I have forgotten anyone who has been part of our journey these years. Thank you, one and all. Jai Hind.